Britain has a long and proud gardening heritage.
And a passion for plants that goes back centuries.
But all is not well in our once green and pleasant land.
Front gardens paved over.
Our lawns lacklustre.
And rare wild flowers on the brink of extinction.
So we need you to help us.
In our campaign to help rediscover
our passion for gardening.
We're going to give you the best gardening tips.
And revealing British gardens that will quite simply take your breath away.
It's time to plant and prune.
And sharpen your shears.
Let the Great British Garden Revival begin.
On tonight's show, James Wong is up on the roof for his garden revival. But first, I champion a great British gardening tradition close to my heart.
What an amazing place. You can't help but be impressed by this really imposing garden. I know I certainly am. This is some of the very best topiary anywhere in the world, and these are extraordinary living sculptures.
Topiary is our great tradition of trimming and shaping plants, from clipped hedges to fantastic sculptures.
Topiary used to be grown right across the country, showing off our great British flair for individuality and that sense of personal style.
But today, it's all too often the preserve of stately homes and formal gardens. The amateur enthusiast's craft is on the wane.
I say it's time to reverse that trend. So sharpen your shears, shape up your garden, and join me, Rachel de Thame, in the Great British Topiary Revival.
To help kickstart this revival across the nation, I'll be unlocking the secrets of topiary's glittering past.
Quite bling.
Oh, yeah,
yes.
Very bling.
Tudor was bling.
I meet the man that's making contemporary topiary accessible to all of us.
It's like painting by numbers, but with hedges.
And I'll show you just how easy it is to make your own creations.
This is going to be something that's going to be in your garden, potentially, certainly as long as you are. Better place for me to start my revival than here at Levens Hall in Cumbria, where you can find not only some of the best, but some of the very oldest topiary anywhere in the world. There's something here for everyone, from the formal and geometric to the quirky and unusual. In fact, topiary in all its many forms gives a garden real identity, and I love it.
But topiary has seen its ups and downs, and many gardeners today see it as a specialist art beyond their capabilities.
If I'm going to revive our passion for topiary, I need to delve into its checkered past and find out exactly why it fell out of favour.
The grand historic gardens at Hatfield House in Hertfordshire provide an incredible insight into topiary fashion right back to Tudor times. Famed as the playground for the young Elizabeth I, I too visited these fantastic gardens as a child, and these visits played a formative part in my love of topiary today.
Wow, just look at this.
It's brilliant, isn't it?
Twiggs Way is a garden historian who shares my passion.
Every time I come here, it's the same reaction.
The light today is fantastic for picking up all of the different foliage textures. You know, you've got the hawthorn,
bay,
and then, of course, the very reliable box.
Take me back to the very beginning. I mean, even the origin of the word topiary.
It comes from the Greek topos, which we have, most people still know through the word topography. And then it becomes applied through the medieval period as a term to clipping and shaping.
Why was it through the medieval period and into the Tudor period that it became so popular?
Well, the Tudors didn't have many flowers to choose from because they hadn't had this huge array of imported plants. You know, if I was stood here in 1500, I'd be really pushed in autumn to actually fill out my garden. So what more splendid than to have intertwining patterns Absolutely. And different foliage textures? You could be bringing me out here to walk on Boxing Day, you Yes. know, and I could still say, wow, that's amazing.
So what kind of specific features might we expect to see in a topiarised Tudor garden?
Well, we'd have the standard clipping, some cones and balls maybe, but actually quite a lot of flamboyance, heraldic features. You know, a fox being chased by a load of hounds, I'd expect to see, and I would love to see it in real life. A man with a sword on horseback.
Quite bling.
Oh, yeah, yes, very bling.
They went
Tudor
for
was
it.
Bling.
This verdant craze for clipping and shaping continued for well over 100 years until it fell out of fashion in the mid-18th century when garden trends changed dramatically and a desire for naturalistic planting and less formal landscapes wiped topiary from estates across the land. Even here at Hatfield, the Tudor-style topiary you see today was only re-established in the 1980s.
So we've seen this sort of remarkable way that topiary's been used for hundreds and hundreds of years. Why is it still relevant today? Why should we be planting it?
As you look at this now, if somebody hadn't planted this, we wouldn't have the chance to enjoy it. You know, these will eventually, unfortunately, die. We've got to start that planting now so future generations can enjoy what we're enjoying. You know, you don't have to create yew buttresses. You can create shapes and figures and scenarios. You can have, you know, funny rabbits jumping across the lawn, you know.
Why
Isn't
not?
That great? Well, yes, it's fantastic. So just take a corner of your garden and have fun.
Fashions come and go, but fortunately, topiary never fell out of favour with the owners here at Levenshall. Known as the judge's wig, this is one of my favourite pieces here. It's got a lovely organic shape across the top, and then you have the opportunity to get inside, which is extraordinary. And you can see all these wonderful, rather sinuous stems going down to the ground. This is native English yew and really ancient. And it also illustrates how the green growing bit here is really only just a covering a few centimetres thick. I think it's extraordinary.
These vast ancient shapes have been clipped and preened by generations of head gardeners, and I'm very excited to be meeting the latest incumbent, Chris Crowder, who's been here 26 years.
One of the things I love about topiary is that it's very touchy-feely. I mean, you can't resist running your hand over it, but what is it that you like?
I love the size of, particularly in this garden, some of the shapes, and because I've done them every year, I feel I'm involved with them. I know them very intimately.
A personal relationship with each piece of topiary.
Absolutely.
And have you got any personal favourites among the topiary pieces in the garden?
Although I do like the big ones, it's some of the ones that are more person-sized, about 6 foot high, the ones that you can walk up to without all the apparatus and just clip them around. They're almost like people.
Are there any you don't like?
As they get old, sometimes they get a bit saggy and loose, I suppose, like all of us, but they can be a bit difficult to treat because you have to just try and hold them up with a bit of wire
yes.
and things like that, and it's not very satisfactory.
So you prefer them young and firm?
That's much better.
It takes Chris and his team 6 months of the year to restore their 100 shrubs and trees to their full shapely glory. Many are so colossal that they can only be accessed using special equipment. Luckily, Chris is going to let me loose and clip some a little closer to the ground.
Well, I'm very excited and somewhat apprehensive because you're going to let me loose on Levens Hall's famous topiary.
Absolutely. They're a matching pair. That's what we're aiming for at the end. Two cones looking the same.
And the box we're starting with here.
It is, yes. The smaller pieces around the garden, they're made of box. You can go up to about 6 feet high, 2 metres with box. Any bigger than that, we're straight into you. But they're both tight-leaved evergreens and they will take a clip.
And what about when to do this? Is there an ideal time during the year?
The best time is after it's got through that first flush of growth in the summer. If you clip it then, it's got time to fill out again, and you may have enough time to clip it once or twice more. And every time you clip it, that's the action that produces more buds and makes a thicker surface for next time.
I think I'm quite old school because I do like to use hand tools, things like the shears and secateurs, but what do you prefer?
These are much more, in a way, satisfyingly handcrafty. At home, hand shears are fine, or even smaller tools, depending on the size of the topiary, really. I suppose the main thing is that they should be sharp. And also, we carry one of these water squirters. If you just run that down the blades every so often, it just stops them getting gummed up, because after a while they get that green residue on them and it just keeps them moving quite nicely.
What about standing back? Because I do that quite a lot while I'm cutting.
That is really important. If you do keep walking away from it, you will see where you're going wrong. And we use a cane as well, certainly on these flat-shaped pieces, because what we think of as flat, if you actually start putting that straight edge against it, you can see we may have taken a little too much off here and there.
Right, Chris, what do you think? I mean, it's not as tightly clipped as yours, but I feel a little caution in someone else's garden is a good thing.
We can always go around it after you've left and finish it off.
Thank you.
If you've gone into brown stuff, though, you'll know you've gone too far.
Yes, definitely. Well, then I'll leave very quickly. Fantastic. It didn't take as long either, did it?
No. It's another 100 and odd to do if you've got the time.
Today, topiary is mainly associated with grand country houses. But throughout history, it's had a place in domestic gardens too, and never more so than in the Edwardian era. And it wasn't just lovingly tended clipped hedges. In typically British style, it was quite common to see teapots or cake stand topiary towering over people's cottages.
In some ways, I really wish that I'd been around to see that. That really was the heyday for topiary. And because I travel now so much for work, I'm very aware that unless it's a big stately home, I hardly ever see topiary. And that's something that I really believe should change.
So I've come to Kent to see a garden that celebrates the art of topiary in spectacular, creative style. Charlotte Molesworth has spent the last 30 years creating this oasis of amazing forms and undulations.
Oh, Charlotte, this is extraordinary. Such an ambitious piece, enormous. How on earth do you do that?
Well, this plant always had this very strong central trunk. So I knew that I was going to tear it, but I can't think why I left so many strong trunks at the top. But I obviously didn't have the heart to cut them off. So I bowed them over and created these sort of strange...
Yes, by simply bending it back down and tying it in. I think it's fantastic. It reminds me of a chess piece.
Is the king.
The king.
The king,
of course. Mm. And then next we hear a more organic, wonderful bird on the top. Is a peacock?
He's a sort of fantasy, really.
Yes.
All the birds are sort of fantasyful. The base is one of the first things I actually clipped when we started the garden, because I knew that whatever was going to be on top, which I had no idea what it was going to be, had to sit on a plinth.
Mm-hmm. It feels wonderful. I mean, it's sort of... you do want to hug it. It's so tactile. It's wonderful, like a giant cushion. What is it about topiary that inspires you?
My mother had a lovely garden and she used topiary in her garden. And I really believe that you slightly garden with your mother's garden in your heart. I mean, it is so versatile, really, that you can be adventurous. You get hooked on it.
Despite my passion for topiary, I've never attempted anything as figurative as this. But with Charlotte as my muse, now seems like a jolly good time to try my hand.
So you found our victim.
Have. Now, this is a pretty woolly old thing. It has got lots of options, and always before you cut, look at all the possibilities, all the sort of potential that it has.
It sort of has a bit of a tailish bit here, maybe. I mean, do we feel the bird?
The first task is to create a plinth for our bird to nest on.
You're very purposeful. You're very definite about it.
Yes, I think one needs to be.
We might have formed the base, but I've no idea how we're going to make a bird out of the rest of this mess. But Charlotte's well up for the challenge.
Now for the exciting part. We have to find a head. And I think this, Rachel, is a good candidate. But it's too thin on its own.
Yes.
So let's put that. And do you think almost a third?
Yes.
So if we tie those three...
So you're tying that up?
Just tying it
together. Tying these three pieces together.
With our bird's head identified, Charlotte's given me the daunting task of giving its body plumage a drastic but shapely trim.
It does feel so final, but here goes.
Great.
Right, and here.
Get rid of it. And that one. Off.
There.
Off.
What about this little chap here?
Off. But marry up the two sides now. Get them a little bit more symmetrical. Marvellous.
Get that last little one over there.
What I think we'll do now to give people cheer is give it this marvellous-looking tail.
Yes.
Sticks and string are Charlotte's low-tech tools of the trade. We're using them to unite and shape our young, flexible tail branches into a wonderful fan. Over time, the wood of the young tail branches will harden into its newly moulded shape and the sticks can be removed.
What do you think?
I think it's jolly good.
Obviously it needs a little imagination now.
And years to grow. And time to grow.
Yes.
Yeah.
But you know, it was so much fun
good.
As well.
I'm glad.
Enormously
I've
enjoyed
it too.
Topiary can make a huge impact on any garden, whether it's for your own private appeal or one like Levenshall that attracts visitors from far and wide. Many of the ancient pieces here have evolved into huge and weird and wonderful shapes, but there are younger examples throughout the formal gardens.
This gorgeous yew spiral is a newcomer. In fact, it's only 15 years old and already looks magnificent. And although this spiral shape looks very complicated, in fact, it's not that difficult to do. I'm feeling so inspired by my visit to Levenshall that I think I'm going to do something to this poor, unsuspecting box cone. I'm going to do a spiral, and they're actually remarkably straightforward to do, she says with confidence. I'm just going to start with some string. Right, and now I'm going to use this to create the spiral shape that I'm going to follow when I start cutting. So, just got to get it on a diagonal. And I'm trying to keep these broader as you go down. So here, a little bit tighter towards the top, and then broadening out lower down. Ideally, you don't want to go right the way down to the bottom of the plant. You want to sort of a tire shape around the base of the cone. I'm going to tie that off. When you're sure that it looks all right, the only thing to do is really just to go for it. I'm just using really sort of heavy-duty kitchen scissors just because they give me that little bit of control. And all I want to do initially is to sort of mark off where that line is. Now, this isn't really a job to be rushed because this is going to be something that's going to be in your garden potentially, well, certainly as long as you are. Now, by this stage, you should be starting to see the outline, you know, where the indentation is and which parts are going to be the fat parts around the spiral.
The next step is to remove the string and to begin cutting a little deeper to increase the definition of the spiral.
If you take too much away, because the stems are all going upright, you lose all the growth above. So I'm still going to work fairly gingerly. Okay, I'm going to now get the hand shears and just sort of shape it generally. So you're sort of rounding off these corners, you know, because at the moment you've got a harsh line top and bottom, and I just want to round those through. You You know, I could go on tweaking this probably all night long. However, I think that's pretty good. Definitely the shape's there, the spiral's there. So I'm pretty pleased with that. And it's so much fun.
I hope I've shown you that topiary is an enjoyable and easy way to add a touch of class to your garden the whole year through. But if you're not convinced, there are a few shortcuts. I've come to Bury St Edmunds to meet artist Steve Manning. 14 years ago, he turned his hand to topiary, but his methods are anything but traditional. Using welded metal wire frames, Steve trains his plants to fill them. The resulting detail is so intricate, even the experts would struggle to match it.
Now, I'm absolutely intrigued by this idea of a wire topiary frame, because I've never done it before. So what have we got here?
Well, it's the Pied Piper of Pakenham being followed by a line of children. They were some of the first frames that we ever made. They're grown in yew. They've been made in galvanised steel wire, like fencing wire. It will eventually get so dense that the frame will hide in there totally in the end. Mm-hmm.
The first thing that strikes me is the level of detail you can get. I mean, look, you can see, I can hold hands, you can see the thumbs there.
Well, that is the good thing with the frames. If I can put the detail in the frames, then at least you've got a chance of achieving that detail at the end of it.
They're extraordinary and nice, well-behaved children when they're made of you, not like mine.
Steve's frames will not bring instant topiary to your garden. This rearing unicorn is one of his tallest pieces. It's already been growing for 12 years and will take another 6 before the yew completely fills the frame.
These are extraordinary. I absolutely love them. And this time made a box. But surely, I mean, this must be several plants along here.
Yes, it was. We started with 10 plants in that one. There's one in each leg, and then the rest went up the body. And this one, we put 8 plants in it.
Yeah, so that one's still got a little bit of growing in to do there.
That's right, we're still growing out. But you've got to remember, we're growing out from this point here to grow the head.
Yes.
So that's a long way that box plant has got to grow in that direction.
Is that tricky to get it to grow that far, sort of horizontally without trying to grow upwards?
Well, what we would do is tie the plant to the underneath of the frame, because most plants will tend to try and grow upwards. So if you let it go along too high, you'll end up with a bit of space underneath that you'll never fill. The beauty with the frame is that anybody can go out there and cut it. You don't have to be an artist to achieve the shape. You've just got to go out there with your shears and keep to the shape of the frame. You know, it's like painting by numbers, but with hedges.
I think I've always been a bit of a purist when it comes to topiary. I haven't wanted to use a frame before, always done it by eye. But having seen what I've seen today, I've been so impressed. I am going to give it a go. And when you get that instant impact in the garden right from the off, there's no excuse not to try.
Large-scale bespoke topiary frames aren't cheap, but don't despair. I've invited some gardening enthusiasts to a local nursery to try their hand at some cheaper and smaller-scale alternatives.
So we've got these, which are, you buy them flat and then they become more three-dimensional. If I just hand those around and sort of see how they work.
What have you got? A duck. And geese?
And a dove.
A dove.
I think that's a chicken.
Chicken.
Yes.
Right.
Yes, I think it's a chicken.
Growing your mini topiary animal in a pot makes it infinitely mobile, so if you move house, your topiary pet can go with you.
So if you put that round, let's try and do it. Let's try and see how... If you squash it...
First, you have to manoeuvre your frame over your mini box plant. A frame like this one costs around £10.
Now, you've got one of these cage types, so let's see how that works. Should we try and ease that? If you push the top of the box in... Oh, here we go.
And then all you have to do is give it a quick haircut.
So what's the general consensus? Do we feel that there's this something you'd like to take up?
It's something that you don't consider doing in a small garden, because you always think it's something that belongs in a stately home garden. And so to be able to achieve something as quickly as we've done today is incredible.
Well, I'm absolutely delighted to hear that I've got 5 new converts. Excellent. No stopping you now.
No.
You see,
That's what I believe about topiary. It's just one of those things that once you start, and you have to just start, don't think about it, don't overanalyze it, just get in, start clipping, and you find out that it's enormous fun, it's rewarding, it's easy to do. And I guarantee once you do start, you won't look back.
Here at Levens Hall, all of these unique topiaries would have been grown from cuttings. It's an incredibly simple skill to acquire and will allow you to grow and clip a whole menagerie of shapes and figures for next to nothing.
Now, if you're clipping box in sort of mid to late summer, it's also a perfect time to collect cuttings for propagation. And box is incredibly forgiving, so that you just snip off some of these nice long shoots. Just take them a little way back into there, so you've got almost a little bit of the old wood there, but otherwise they're semi-ripe. Just take those off. And ideally, you do this first thing in the morning is always great, because the plant's taken up lots of moisture overnight. And these will all make new little box plants. Now, that's a nice little pile of cuttings there. Now, the thing with box is that it's generally incredibly easy to grow. So instead of putting it into a pot and growing it in a greenhouse or in a cold frame, I'm going to do it here straight into the ground. Now, these are semi-ripe cuttings, which means that all of this growth has come this year. And you can see the tips, they're still very soft. But then here along the stem, well, that's got a bit of bend in it, but it's semi-ripe. And then here at the very end, this little bit is last year's wood, and it's become quite tough. So I'm just going to snip off a bit of that at the end, and you do that just underneath a pair of leaves, and then I'm just going to strip all of these lower leaves from the stem. You want to expose a good sort of half to two-thirds of the stem, and that's so that these new little plants don't get stressed by having too much leafage on there that they have to support. I do love this idea of getting plants for free. And I know that with something like box, you've got to wait a little while. I mean, they're not the fastest growing plant, but you'd be surprised. You know, you'll forget about them a couple of years later, think, oh my goodness, I did that and didn't pay anything for it. I've forked over this bit of ground and also weeded it to make sure that there's nothing competing with the new little plants. And then I'm just using a pencil as a dibber, really, just sort of waggling that around to give a bit of space. And then just dropping the cutting in and firming it back round. And I'm just gonna do that in a row, right the way along here. Now I'm putting these in about 5 or 6 inches apart, which is just about close enough to give a nice dense little hedge. But also, if I decide to dig something up and replant it, move it somewhere else or pot it up, then I can get in there. It's enough space between them to do that. And then just make sure that they stay moist, that they don't really dry out. My father used to say, throw a stick in the ground and it'll grow. And in the case of box cuttings, it really is true.
It will take about 2 years for these cuttings to fully establish and grow into small, bushy plants. But then within a few more years, you could have your very own little Levens Hall right on your doorstep. Imagine that. As we've seen, topiary knows no bounds, and armed with his shears, one man is causing quite a stir on the streets of North London. After years of giving his mature privet hedge the bog standard short back and sides, Tim Bush was challenged to wield his shears to more artistic effect.
I got into topiary about 4 years ago, following a request from my wife to make a cat in the front garden. Which is this hedge, and I decided the cat was far too complicated. So started cutting a tube shape and then realised that maybe a steam train could come from the tube. 4 years later, this is the end result of that.
The steam train gave Tim the confidence to attempt the cats his wife had so desperately wanted in the neighbour's hedge across the road. And after that, commissions rolled in.
At the moment, I'm working on a herd of elephants in Finsbury Park.
I remember the first time I walked by after Tim had cut these bushes, and all of a sudden I stopped and I went, wait a minute, there's elephants over there across the street.
I think they're great. They give you a smile every time you walk by, so it just cheers up the whole neighbourhood.
May all overgrown hedges be turned into topiary, I say.
And with the proceeds from Tim's clipping talents pouring in, it's not just the neighbours who treasure his work.
instead of just cutting them for fun, I cut them for charity. So at the moment, I'm cutting them for Home Farm Trust, a charity that supports people like my sister who's got learning difficulties. We're up to £1,200, and I have a target of £5,000 ultimately, which is enough to inspire me to carry on for a little bit longer and do a few more hedges around the neighbourhood.
I hope I've convinced you of the wonders of topiary, but this great art and historic form of gardening is in real danger of being lost. And I strongly believe that it should have a place in our gardens today and in the future. So get clipping. It's time for the Great British Topiary Revival to begin.
Next, someone else who is passionate about the Garden Revival campaign.
Like most of us Brits, I live in the city where access to green space is increasingly limited. But I believe human beings need access to nature. It's vital for our well-being.
There's masses of urban space out there just waiting to be transformed into brilliant new gardens. You just have to look up.
The idea to create gardens on the tops of buildings is a modernist dream from over a century ago.
But roof gardens were way ahead of their time and fell into decline following their heyday in the first half of the 20th century. Even though they are rooted in our past, I believe they are the gardens of the future.
So join me, James Wong, up on the roof to utilise a space that could make our lives cleaner, greener, and bust the stress of modern living. Now is the time for the Great British Roof Garden Revival.
On my campaign, I'll be exploring one of Britain's most incredible roof gardens.
If I was to pick one plant that I'd say, like, there's absolutely no way you could ever grow on a roof, it'd be an oak tree, and these have been here for three quarters of a century.
I meet one woman who's lifted almost an entire garden into the sky.
I'm so jealous of this. I like it a little bit too much.
And if you want to know where to start and what plants work well in roof gardens, I'll be revealing all.
It's an antidepressant in a plant. Some of our most incredible gardens can be found in totally unexpected places. Here I am in the centre of London with three roof gardens right in front of me. And that right there is Cannon Street, one of our busiest stations with the River Thames and the London skyline wrapping around me.
But sadly, Britain's roof gardens are few and far between. So I'm basing my revival campaign right here in the centre of London, on the top of Japanese investment bank Nomura, which features a stunning roof garden. It's a surprising green oasis in the heart of the city's financial hub, with vegetables growing alongside beautiful beds of ornamental grasses. And it's the perfect example of what more of our city buildings could look like.
I grew up in Singapore, one of the most densely populated cities on the planet. And building gardens in the sky there is a standard part of urban planning. They don't see them as frivolous decoration, of course. They see them as genuine solutions to 21st century problems. They can mop up pollution. They can cool overheated cities.
But to appreciate why now is the time for roof gardens to undergo a revival, I need to delve into their history. Britain's roof gardens began in the 1920s, when department store Selfridges set a trend with a flamboyant pleasure garden. It was the place to be seen. Other department stores followed, and when Derry and Tom's store opened on Kensington High Street in 1933, the decadent Kensington Roof Garden was born and became an icon of its time.
And look at this. I've been transported to the Med. It's amazing to believe that this Spanish garden is just one of three different gardens. There's a woodland garden with its very own river. There's a Tudor-themed garden, all floating 100 foot above the bustling streets of London. It's a horticultural miracle.
To discover more about what makes these gardens so enchanting, head gardener David Lewis shed some light on their history.
People think about green roofs as this really cutting-edge idea, but almost 100 years ago, this was a proper garden with trees and fountains and turrets and all sorts of things.
Absolutely. The department stores loved them, so Selfridges built theirs, as you say, 100 years ago. And then Derry and Tom's,
really wanted something more spectacular, more special, so they created this. So it's an acre and a half of proper gardens on top of their roof.
So this is a competition. You get department stores all over the country all competing to outdo each other.
Yes. It was a novelty to draw people to a commercial enterprise. It took them 2 years to build this, and I'm sure every bit of soil was carried up a staircase on someone's back.
At practically the size of a football pitch, there's an abundance of magnificent gardens to discover. But it's not only flora up here. There are also ducks and, unbelievably, pink flamingos that have inhabited these exquisite grounds for the last 35 years. There are 125 trees on this rooftop, 52 of which are situated in the spectacular woodland area.
What I can't believe it is the size of everything and the maturity. How did they get the trees up here in the first place?
Well, they winched 70 trees up the side of the building by hand, as far as we know.
I'd love to have seen that.
I know, and at night.
Oak trees. If I was to pick one plant that I'd say, like, there's absolutely no way you could ever grow on a roof, it'd be an oak tree, and these have been here for three quarters of a century.
But you've got to remember, they were much smaller than this. You know, you couldn't plant a tree this size into 18 inches of soil.
That's all you've got?
That's all we've got, everywhere.
I find that incredible. 18 inches is what, like the height of my knee,
yeah,
in terms of pots?
Well, they were planted small and allowed to grow. But the great thing is their roots accommodate themselves, so they've just gone outwards.
That's a really good tip, to start small. Some quick-growing stuff could get there really quickly, something like a eucalyptus or a cordyline in a small pot.
Yeah, yeah, certainly in a pot.
You can get the same effect in 5 years.
Yes, exactly.
During the Blitz, many of London's roof gardens were destroyed. So how come much of this one survived?
It's been under threat in several ways. A couple of bombs dropped on the building during the war. One demolished the tower in the Spanish Garden. The other one landed, didn't go off, so they picked it up, put it in front of the tower and took a postcard of it.
Talk about hardy war spirit.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
In the 30s, when these gardens were built, it was considered the model of things to come. The future wouldn't be about smog-clad Victorian cities. It'd be about flying cars, and cantilevered sky gardens hanging off every tower block would be commonplace.
But that wasn't to be. Sadly, roof gardens have disappeared over the years. The Adelaide House Building in London Bridge is another classic example of this decline.
This, believe it or not, was once a pleasure ground for stressed-out city office workers. It had rolling lawns of soft Cumberland turf and a flashy 18-hole putting green. It was cutting-edge, it was forward-thinking, it was right up there. Now look at it.
The urban oasis became a victim of development. In the 1970s, an additional floor was added to the building, and its garden and putting green were lost forever.
Although this utopian ideal may be long forgotten about up on this roof today, it may have an effect that its founder had never imagined.
Cities in the UK can be warmer than the surrounding countryside by up to 6 to 8 degrees.
That's because bricks and mortar can work like a giant storage heater, absorbing and retaining heat from the sun. It's a phenomenon called the urban heat island effect.
But gardens built on roofs absorb this heat instead, helping to keep the buildings cool.
So come on, Britain, this is not just about aesthetics. Imagine the potential here. A garden on every urban roof could help cool and shade the centre of our cities. It could help absorb water, reduce flooding, provide a haven for wildlife. But ultimately, it could look and feel a whole lot more inspiring than this.
Even though some roof gardens haven't lasted the test of time, here in the capital, this one, on top of an investment bank, is paving the way for a revival. But there are some practicalities you've got to consider first.
Roof gardens come in all shapes and sizes, but there are two factors that almost all of them have in common. And the most important in my mind is root space. You're either probably going to be growing in pots or really shallow beds like this, because roofs can only take so much weight. So they don't have the luxury of roots spreading all over the place. And the second one is wind. We're up effectively on a man-made cliff face, and that can mean an almost constant battering by the wind. You'd think those two factors would mean that you can't have fantastically verdant plant growth. But it couldn't be any further from the case if you pick the right plants. Up in the front here, we've got what looks cute and adorable and very cottage-like. This erigeron is from Mexico.
and it naturalises all over the UK in cracks and little walls, just like a buddleia. If it will grow in that kind of super minimal root space, this is pure luxury for it. This gaura may look delicate with these beautiful white petals, but it comes from really arid areas of the southwest United States and may even self-seed its way through your beds, creating a lovely drift. Anything with a thick leaf, and we're talking this phormium, for example, we're talking this cordyline, they may look lush and tropical, but the second you touch their leaves, you'll realise these guys, they've been used as fibre plants. They will handle anything that a blizzard can throw at them. Almost anything, if you're not a plant geek, with the words maritimum or litoralis in the Latin name, basically means grows by the seaside, they'll go brilliantly up here. They get the extra heat that the building really kicks out, and they will absolutely love it. Think roof gardens are an inhospitable environment? Then think again. This little Mediterranean plant, lavender, has made a break for it. These flowers have seeded throughout here. And look at it, it's thriving in gravel. No watering, no fertilizer, no care, looking brilliant. Right plant, right place, and 90% of your job is done. Get your kit sorted, and I'll make a sky gardener out of anyone. Let's talk containers, because that's how the vast majority of people will be getting started. You need them to be light, and you need them to be non-porous. If you think about clay or terracotta, not only are they incredibly heavy, but they're porous. They contain tiny air spaces, which allows water to dry out of the side of them, meaning you need to get out there with a hose so much more often. Something like this, incredibly light, false bottom, so you don't have to fill it up all the way. Cheap and easy to get hold of, I'd go for things like aluminium, zinc, and lightweight polymers like this. To reduce the weight even further, I'm gonna fill up to 50% of the pot with this stuff. It's expanded clay, and it basically looks like one of those chocolate breakfast cereals and has about the same weight to it. Fills up a lot of space and absorbs water, so great drainage, but also holds on to that little bit of moisture. I'm just pouring in regular potting compost you can get in any garden centre. I'm going to pop in this lovely phormium.
Phormiums are perfect for roof gardens. They're tough, low maintenance, and planted like this won't need a lot of watering.
People say to me all the time that they've only got a small roof garden, I can only grow stuff in pots, I can't have a proper garden. We live in the 21st century, and you can grow your own way. Why be grounded when you can live elevated? I'm almost done here, but there's one super geeky tip that I have to share with you. It's an idea I picked up in Latin America. It looks a little bit like an Indiana Jones relic, so you may be wondering why I'm using it. This guy is called an olla. It's any kind of unglazed terracotta vase type contraption. You're gonna bury it up to its neck in compost. You fill it with water, and amazingly, it will give it to your plants only when they need it. When the soil is dry, water will seep out of this and into the compost. It's low-tech genius. All I'm gonna do now, bit of a top dress. Fancy word for some pebbles going over the surface. And this gives a really neat sort of finished look, but also insulates the water on the inside, preventing evaporation from the soil surface. It means you need to water less.
With these simple tips, you'll be spending less time watering and more time enjoying your roof garden. One person who has really mastered planting on high is Bahamian-born artist Lynn Perotti. Just over 2 years ago, Lynn moved from a house with a garden into a rooftop apartment in West London. She not only moved her paintings, but also dug up her plants. Some were craned in and others carried up 6 flights of stairs. Against all odds, she successfully relocated them into their new environment.
Look at this. I'm so jealous of this. I like it a little bit too much. And so many people in a new build property like this would probably stick a table and chair out so you can really see the view, but wouldn't go to town on the planting, because that's work.
No, that's not me. That's not me, because my plants mean a lot to me. They all have a history. I can show you plants that my dad bought for me when he was last visiting from the Bahamas. I just have to make sure they're healthy and living. And in fact, I'm quite annoyed at the moment because there's this black beetle which has attacked a few of the leaves.
And you take it so personally if you're a real gardener.
Like, what's he doing?
You know? I love the idea that if you're a really obsessive plant person, it's not a choice. It's not like you could have put plants here or you couldn't. You have to have them here, like, because life wouldn't be worth living otherwise.
Can you imagine this terrace with just a seating area?
This is a roof garden to die for. Lynn's transformed it from a bare roof to something that's not only satisfying her passion for plants, but also benefits the environment and wildlife. And in doing this, she's learned some tips along the way. It's quite a different skill set, quite different circumstances growing on a roof than growing anywhere else.
It is indeed, but drainage is one of the most important, you know, sort of dogma.
Yeah.
And the second thing is, I find that one must never let the containers dry out, because if you do, then you're really struggling to resaturate again.
Insufficient drainage could lead to root rot or drowned plants. So it's important to strike the right balance when watering, which is something that Lynn has a clever solution for.
I do have an irrigation system for most of the pots. Very, very important. You can set the timer if it gets really, really hot, or you can turn it off if it's raining.
The sheer variety of plants that Lynn has growing up here is incredible. From a bounty of fruit and veg to magnificent flowers, there doesn't seem to be much she can't grow. Do you miss ground floor gardening?
No, not really, because one of the benefits of this garden, and a definite change, is you can really control specific soil requirements for things like these tomatoes.
That's such a bonus, because it means you can choose your soil type. You're not stuck with clay or acid or alkaline. You can have a bed of each.
Exactly. That's one of the reasons why I find this sort of gardening a bit easier.
Easier than growing on
there? Easier, because you can actually really control what you're going to plant precisely where, and off we go.
Hence,
I have a bumper crop of tomato.
If you're considering roof gardening, it's worth seeking professional advice from an architect or structural engineer before you plant anything substantial on your roof or balcony. There's this general assumption that roof gardens are a real second-rate citizen compared to regular, proper gardens. People think about them as this huge project that you've got to put together that's going to cost loads of money and never really look right, never really look mature. This garden completely blows it out of the water. It doesn't cost any more than your average deck garden. It just happens to be floating in the sky. It looks great and probably is a lot less work. Why doesn't every rooftop have one of these? Back under Moira's rooftop, there's a wonderful display of ornamental grasses. Using these beautiful plants is a fantastic way to start your very own rooftop garden. And Chelsea Flower Show gold medal winning grasses expert Neil Lucas is going to explain how. I don't think I've ever seen healthier grasses growing right up here. And look at the amount of soil they're in. There's almost nothing to them.
There's virtually nothing, which of course is one of the defining things of a roof garden, isn't it? That there's only soil about that kind of depth, and yet these things are looking absolutely fantastic.
People think that on roof gardens you've also got to have everything in tiny pots that's all stunted and a bit miserable looking. They're not proper plants. Whereas this oak grass is significantly taller than me. They look like a mature garden.
Absolutely. It's got that feeling of space, of enclosure. And the grasses, they take an empty flat space and turn it into something exciting.
What makes them so great for roof gardens?
Well, I think it's their adaptability, James, to be honest. They come from, if you think, steppes, prairies, big open places where there's lots of wind, often there's very little soil, very little water, and so grasses have come used over thousands of years to adapting to difficult situations. The secret is to choose plants that grow in the kind of conditions you've got. That's what the guys have done here. They've chosen the fountain grasses, the golden oak grasses, and they're absolutely loving these kind of open, frequently windy conditions.
Golden oak grass is great value. Its architectural foliage can reach up to 2 meters high, and the soft, feathery flowers are magnificent in June. There's so much variation here. I think people think about grasses as lawn, full stop.
Well, actually, our lawns are made up of this kind of grass. This is a stoloniferous type, i.e. it runs.
These are the stolons.
These are the stolons.
The underground stems,
yep,
that kind of pop up where you least expect it.
There. Yeah, and they will run along and they will gradually send up another plant. They're great for gardens. And if you look behind you there...
Which one?
Any one of those, that one,
yeah.
that's the bronze sedge there. Can you see the difference in the root system?
Totally. This is straight up and down.
Absolutely.
And this is spreading out and trying to colonise wherever it can go.
Exactly, whereas this is forming a clump. Say, however long the plant stays in the ground,
yeah.
it only ever makes a clump. So for roof gardens, generally it's the clump formers that you want, and there are hundreds of them to choose from.
And colour as well, they're not all green. But we've got this crazy kind of fibre optic ginger freckle stuff yeah. here. We've got this very elegant, almost bamboo-like yeah. Yeah. one.
The Japanese bloodgrass.
It looks like feathers of some kind of subtropical bird.
Beautiful colours, aren't they? Absolutely fabulous. And grasses work so well with other plants. And if you look at this, I mean, the flowers that we have here, the golden oak grass and the penicetum, fantastic flower. That is wow factor flower that lasts all the way through the year.
Plant roses, you get a fantastic display in June, and general black-spotted miserableness for the rest of the year.
You've noticed, yeah.
This guy, right yeah. into December, these flower heads would stay on there. Even covered in a frost, they still look beautiful.
Penicetum's beautiful brush-like flowers just go on and on, as undemanding as they are impressive. With the population growing, open spaces are being sacrificed for development. And in many UK cities, there just isn't enough green space for people to enjoy.
I believe that everyone should have the right to have access to green space, and thankfully, not alone.
Here in Birmingham, a cutting-edge new library has been built, and sitting atop is a brand new roof garden. The building is a fusion of modern architectural style and garden landscaping, right in the city centre. One of the library's senior managers, Sarah Rowell, explains how the garden benefits the community.
Where did the idea for creating a garden up in the sky here first come about?
Well, as we were developing the vision for the new library, we realised we had a great opportunity here to create some really beautiful green open space.
And Birmingham, when you look out, actually doesn't have that much green space in its centre, so this must be really valuable.
It is, absolutely, and of course being in the library, it's the place that all the community can come in and really enjoy the space, come and relax out here with a book maybe and a cup of tea.
And is this just aesthetic? Is it like a giant window box that just looks pretty, or does it have other functions?
No, not at all. I mean, we started off from the point of view of thinking, well, we just wanted some really beautiful planting, and then of course we realised the opportunities that we had if we started to introduce fruit, vegetables and herbs, for example. We'd very much like to see some of the food that we're growing out here on the terrace find its way into the dishes that we're serving in our cafe. That's a really sort of excellent example of how the library is a very sustainable building as well.
The roof terrace also helps offset the library's carbon emissions and attract wildlife. So everyone's a winner, especially the city-dwelling local volunteers who help maintain it. Like Jean, who misses growing veg in her own back garden.
I've had various gardens all through my life, and now, of course, I've just got a little balcony. The chance to do a bit more gardening on a bigger scale really appeals.
And Jim, who left his rural home and gardening hobby behind for city life.
I never actually felt quite all right without a garden. I really wanted to, you know, I regretted the fact that I didn't have a nice terrace like some of the other flats in the development and all of that.
We all have the right to enjoy green, open spaces, whether in the country or the city, and it's easily done. And these volunteers are living proof.
What can I help you out over here with?
Ah, curly kale is what we're planting here, and cabbages there.
Excellent. Yeah. So what do you think about the future of roof gardens?
Oh, I think it's a great resource. It's fantastic. And in many ways, parts of these gardens on these terraces, they're just like public parks. It's just that they're using this space. But just look around the city, they're everywhere. You can see acres of just empty rooftops just waiting to be developed.
I guess it could totally change how we think of cities, Jim.
I think it might, yes, and for the better. There'll now be an added interest in the roof garden, in the tops and what's going on up on top of the building, not just what it looks like from the street.
With around 4,000 community groups involved with urban green spaces across the UK, Jean and Jim aren't the only volunteers championing the revival of rooftop gardens.
So what do you think roof gardens like this offer a city like Birmingham?
Well, it beautifies it. Without something like this on the skyline, it's going to look pretty grey. But if this could inspire other buildings to do the same thing, then that would be wonderful.
I think it's a matter of giving to the community. And the gardening is obviously giving beauty to the library also, so.
I love the fact that you can be a gardening geek even if you don't have a garden by doing volunteering like this. In the grand scheme of pulling off a giant, shiny new building like this, This roof garden really wasn't that hard to do and wasn't even that expensive to do. These gardens offer so much value to so many people and cost so little. It's incredible why it isn't mandatory. I mean, look at this garden. Then, let's have a look at the alternative.
If green space is lacking in your life, there may well be a community roof garden for you to enjoy, or you could even start one of your very own. When night falls, it doesn't mean that gardens can't be enjoyed. This roof garden in the heart of the capital has become a truly sensory experience.
If you were a city slicker, simply stepping out onto your roof terrace in an evening after work is enough to make you feel like your blood pressure has just dropped a couple of points. It's the ultimate stress relief. And if you're working hard and doing overtime, I don't see any reason why your plants shouldn't be doing it too. They don't need to look good in the middle of the day when you're not around. They need to look their best shining out in twilight. And for that, you can't beat anything with really pale, white or silvery colours. The brilliant thing about things with paler colours is they're usually the very things that are scented, particularly at night. I've got a really special find here, Sestrum nocturnum, designed for moths and liked by humans.
Plants like these have evolved to attract nocturnal pollinators, like moths and bats, with their intoxicating scent.
Incredibly delicate orange flower fragrance. It's an antidepressant in a plant. You're going right at the front of the border. The brilliant thing is, you don't actually just have to go for a pale palette of white on its own. Just that little hint of color, like this pale pink tulbagia, what they call society garlic, and this really light blue agapanthus here, really set off that white to stop it looking flat and make it appear like you've strung up fairy lights all over your garden. I love texture as well in a garden, and these flowering heads of pennisetum and this miscanthus over here are so textural that you've just got to run your hands through them. Look incredible as they slowly move in the wind.
Sestrum nocturnum grows very fast and blooms on and off throughout the warmer months of the year. A roof garden enjoyed in the evenings would be lost without it. I'm pleased to report that it's not only me who recognises the immense contribution that roof gardens can make to our lives. There are others out there championing gardens in the sky. And Gillian Edwards from Northwest London is one of those champions.
I think it's really important, if we can, to have access to some kind of greenery, some kind of nature. Coming back after work and being able to sit out here and look after my vegetables and pick my flowers and just get involved with the earth in some way keeps me sane. I'm really proud of this. This is my first ever squash that I've grown.
Gillian's used nearly every inch of her terrace and hasn't been defeated by the structural restrictions of the building.
One of the limitations or the challenges of growing anything on this roof is that I'm not allowed to have pots right on the asphalt itself because that would damage the roof. So what I've had to do is build shelves all the way around. So everything is growing 6 inches off the ground. Here we've got the first of the tomatoes. These ones actually self-seeded from last year and they just obviously wanted to grow, so I just thought I'll let them grow. In containers, you can only grow things which have relatively small roots. So next year, more of the salad crops, more beans, masses of lettuce again, because it makes a great gift. It's a lovely way to be able to share your produce.
Imagine this view if every building out there was topped with its own roof garden. Even if you've only got a couple of square meters to play with, just popping some plants out there, it's so simple to do and can genuinely change your life. Now is the time for a roof garden revival.